Aphelion is the point in orbit of a planet, asteroid, or comet at which it is the furthest from the sun. In this work, I attempt to capture some of the mystery and excitement of our solar system. This work was inspired by my love for music of John Coltrane, Gustav Holst, and Astor Piazzolla.
Thank you. And that program note was written by the composer Giovanni Santos. Thank you. For those of you joining us on live stream, we're so happy to have you here with us. And if you hear a smattering of applause, we welcome our Dean of Arts and Humanities at Pierce College, Dr. Holly Smith, who's in the audience, as well as a few people helping us to make this happen backstage. Jim Butler and Christian Amundsen, we're very happy to have you with us as well. The next piece will be Stephen Bryant's Dusk, and we will have Tabitha, one of our trumpet players, read a program note that she wrote. Thank you.
Dusk is a piece of music composed in 2004 by Stephen Bryant. As an award-winning composer, Stephen wanted to capture the moment where dusk hits, when the sunset ends. Born in 1972, Stephen Bryant was a three-time recipient of the National Band Association's Willem D. Prevailing Composition Award. He studied at the Juilliard School, University of North Texas, and Ouachita University. He is best known for the orchestral work Luz LD for Orchestra and Static Waters.
Thank you.
composed and written for a flexible instrumentation ensemble like the group you see before you. So one of the things that we had to do with performing in a COVID-19 socially distant space is to only offer this music class to students who were enrolled in Pierce, and we had to disinvite, that's a bad word, we had to ask our community members to wait at home until it's safe for everybody to return to campus. That being the case, we have a small group and a pretty interesting instrumentation. And so most of the music composed in the orchestra and band repertoire that we would normally have access to play doesn't work because it's missing instruments and it's missing balance, key issues, things like that. But this piece, The Telltale Heart, was actually composed in 2021 and meant to be played by an ensemble of any instruments that show up to a rehearsal and a performance. So based on who you put on what part, every part is covered. And so this is gonna be the world premiere, actually, of this piece, Ryan J. Williams' The Telltale Heart. And we're going to have Carlos read a program note that Issa, our cello player, wrote. So here is the program note.
In 1843, Edgar Allan Poe, American horror author and poet, wrote a short story titled The Telltale Heart. This very popular work of writing has been pondered over many generations and has even been used as a studying point for Gothic writing and themes in public education. Like many of us, Ryan J. Williams grew up with the daunting stories of Poe and decided to make his expression of the plot. As a refresher, we begin our story by hearing from a man who resides in the same living quarters as an old man with a quote-unquote vulture's eye. Throughout the story, the narrator tries to convince the audience that his actions are not the result of delusion, although his actions can seem quite delusional, like watching the old man while he sleeps every night for what seems like a week. Finally, the narrator acts upon his discomfort with the sound of the old man's heartbeats and murders him. After his crime, the narrator hides the body underneath the floorboards. The narrator's neighbors hear all the ruckus and call the police. When they arrive, our narrator tells the police that all is well, and that the old man is just out of town for a few days. As the police sit down and talk for a few minutes, the speaker begins to hear the old man's heartbeat once again. The sound keeps getting louder and louder. He seems to go mad, and then admits his crime to the police. Williams does an amazing job representing both the discomfort and dreaminess of this short story through his harmonies. This piece is a great example of what it is like to capture not only a feeling, but a story.
Without further ado, the world premiere of Ryan J. Williams' The Telltale Heart.
Thank you.
you. We will now take a 7-minute intermission and be back with our second half.
Thank you.
the second half. We are going to begin with two pieces that we're actually splitting the group into two smaller ensembles. The first will be a student arranged transcription of a Haydn piano concerto / divertimento. It is arranged by our pianist and soloist, Kenny Ritchie, and we'll have the program note read by Megan, our clarinetist.
Joseph Haydn, born on March 31st of 1732, was a turning point for classical music. Not only was he an inspiration for other greats in the classical music industry, but he was attributed titles such as Father of Symphony and Father of String Quartets. Haydn was put on the map with his first composition, The Leaping Devil, which was written as a comedy. Shortly after the debut, Haydn was hired as a music director and worked until he became ill in 1802. Shortly thereafter, he passed away in 1809. This did not mark the end of his music career, though. Haydn has been immortalized by his works and is celebrated to this day. His works can be heard through symphonies all over the world. Haydn was known for not writing with an idea or picture in mind for each piece, but rather purely for his audience's enjoyment. He wanted to write pieces that would appeal to the public because he wanted people to feel joy. This gave Haydn's pieces a unique sound that was distinguishable between other classical composers. Divertimento in C major 14, the first movement, Allegro, is no exception. Halfway through the piece, the distinct Haydn key and temporary mood change is heard, that is, before it loops back around to the original melody. Divertimento in C major feels like a dance with some drama tossed in there to keep listeners on edge, waiting for what could happen next. It will not leave listeners disappointed and is meant to keep attention throughout.
Thank you.
Next, you're going to hear the five students who did not perform on that piece. While we were working on the Haydn with the winds and piano, our percussionists and cellist were working on another student arrangement. We had so much fun playing the student selection Coldplay Classics last quarter, and it was such an audience hit too, that one of our students, Killian Inglet, wrote an arrangement of some more Coldplay songs. So, hope you like Coldplay, because apparently we can't escape it here at Pierce College. I'm going to have Ethan read Killian's program notes so you know what's coming up.
As the ensemble students of Pierce College in Puyallup returned to class for the first time during the COVID-19 pandemic, Flexband music was used to incorporate the mixed instrumentation of the group. After playing through Coldplay Classics, arranged by Michael Brown that first quarter, Killian Inglet was inspired to create an arrangement featuring some of Coldplay's earlier hits. When asked to perform a percussion ensemble piece the following quarter, the group decided that Inglet could arrange the follow-up arrangement of the previously played Coldplay Classics. Inglet had written up a few other short percussion ensemble arrangements before this. However, none of them had been performed publicly. Being familiar with both the performers in the group and the instrumentation provided, the piece was tailored to fit what each performer in the group does best, while keeping a limit of five music parts for the five players, including himself. Following the style of the original Coldplay Classics, the piece is a two-movement medley of pop songs. The original Coldplay Classics used some of Coldplay's chart toppers from the late 2000s and early 2010s. Coldplay Classic 2 focuses in on early 2000s hits only, with Yellow and The Scientist. A solo instrumentalist is featured throughout, taking the place of the lead vocal. voice for each movement. As it is supposed to represent vocal singing, the solo part is open to the performer's judgment on which instrument it is played on and the phrasing of the written notes.
Before we move on to our next piece, we'd like to take a moment to recognize the students who have been with our group for at least this year, if not for the last 2 years, as they are graduating, finishing their time at Pierce, and moving on. We have Samira Vincent. Samira, will you stand up here? Samira is finishing her associate's degree in music, and she will be transferring to the Eastman School of Music back in New York State in oboe performance. So we're very proud of her and happy to have her heading off there as well. Next up, we have Talia Williamson. Talia Williamson. Talia's been monumental in bringing up the back section there with our percussion in the last 2 years. Talia is heading to the Northwest.
I'm taking a gap year.
That's right. Okay, so she'll be taking a gap year this next year and then heading to Northwest University the following fall, also majoring in music. So we're very proud of you. Thank you, Talia. And finally, I just found this out yesterday. I mean, I think we had this communication, but I thought we had one more year with our other amazing oboe player, Perez Whitmore. Perez, will you stand up? So he is leading us for a music degree program at University of North Carolina at Greensboro, which is an amazing school. And so we're very proud of you, wishing you well. And even though you can't be with us here, we hope that you'll be with us still in spirit. Thank you for being here, Perez. And thank you to all our graduates. All right, our next piece is maybe the strangest one on the concert, but that isn't a subjective statement. It's mostly just objective. I personally love it. This is Eric Pescona's Steampunk Suite, or, well, this is actually the Steampunk Scenes for Flexible Ensemble based off of the Steampunk Suite that she composed originally for concert band. And we are going to have Edwin. Edwin is going to read us the program now to explain a little bit more about this piece. It will be a four-movement piece. If you want to clap between movements, you're welcome to. But otherwise, be anticipating that the next four little vignettes you hear are all interrelated on the same piece.
Steampunk Scenes was composed by the virtuosic Dr. Erica Svanu in the year 2015. Steampunk Scenes gives up a humorous and early mechanical visions that have been portrayed in movies such as The Lone Ranger. The first movement, Charlie and the Mechanical Marching Band, contains dissonances that are implemented in generous ways to give off a sense of humor and craziness in a Sousa Marsh style. Various special percussion instruments, pitayandos and accelerandos, are used to emphasize the sense of humor. Melodies are also interchanged between instruments that give an interesting taste to an already existing melody. The second movement starts up with the ringing bells of the marimba in an unpleasant and just gorgeous way, which the saxophone will then carry on throughout this movement. A mixture of the minor and major modes gives off a sense of confusion in the pleasant environment. The third movement starts off with the clarinet giving off a sensation of light and being weightless in a buoyant, rich world. The interesting patterns and the repetition of melodies give off a feeling of progression and continuation that one experiences when taking flight lessons. The fourth movement has a strong circus-like theme that one might describe as a humorous and rhythmic. The mixture of dissonances along aside the rhythmic patterns blends well with the piece's intentions. The chromatic runs that are present further exaggerate the humorous theme intended for this movement. Dr. Erica Svanu is best known for her prized compositions of Band of Heroes and Mary Shelley Meets Frankenstein, a modern Promethean tango. Dr. Erica Svanu is a conductor of the Oxford Concert Band and Oxford University and was composer teacher at Medici State University, the University of New Hampshire, Ohio State University, Mwando, Wisconsin High School, and through Arts Integration in NOMI. Dr. Erica Svanu is also an active freelance composer, conductor, clinician, and the creator of Mary and Mr. Darcy, the Pride and Prejudice Guardian.
This piece will also feature our pianist, Kenny Ritchie, on the accordion, which they learned specifically for this piece. Godspeed, Kenny, and Godspeed, Ensemble.
Thank you. Thank you.
tune on our concert and on our season. Thank you so much for attending. For those of you that are with us at home, we really appreciate the support, even if it's virtual. We hope that you can attend an in-person concert, hopefully as soon as possible, possibly by this fall when we return to campus being more open. We will continue to have the hybrid ensemble giving performances even as we bring our band and orchestra back on campus. So if anything, one great thing to come out of the pandemic is the birth of this new group, and I'm really excited to see the different directions that we can take this group that's gonna still continue to meet once a week. We are gonna finish up with Sharp Nine, which is a piece of more traditional jazz featuring improvisation and improvised solos from a few students. I wanna make sure I got their names out there before we have our pianist Kenny read the final program note. So when you do hear the improvised solos in a moment, the students who are standing are making up solos on the spot in the jazz idiom, and that's gonna be Joey on piccolo, Perez on oboe, Megan on clarinet, Edwin on alto saxophone, Tabitha on trumpet, and we'll finish up with Kenny on piano. But first, let's hear from them on this program note.
In an effort to bring blues and jazz improvisation to a traditional wind band setting, Omar Thomas envisioned and constructed Sharp Nine. By containing natural and altered tensions on diminished chords, the piece introduces a rarely heard sound in wind ensembles. Written for five parts rather than a standard set of instruments, the piece is a perfect choice for wind bands and mixed ensembles alike. The mixed timbres of varied sets of instruments can add a lot to the old-timey ragtime groove of the piece. Sharp Nine is a straight eights, specifically New Orleans ragtime, 12-bar blues in B-flat, playing homage to Charles Joseph Buddy Bolden, an early jazz pioneer and cornetist. The piece is constructed with an introduction where all instruments play together, followed by a solo section. A soloist may play a 4-bar or 12-measure solo, while the other instruments play from a selection of backing tracks. Solos are traded between instruments played in a series of multiple 4-bar choruses by a single soloist, or played at the same time by multiple soloists. The solo sections provide a great learning experience for most band members, old and new alike, as well as add to the unpredictable and free-flowing nature of the piece.